Thank you all for being here. And I actually want to add one thing to my bio. Diane mentioned that I had been in a family business, and then in 1989, I started my own business as a socially and environmentally responsible business. And I did that because I was inspired by an extraordinary organization called the Social Venture Network, where I met with many other people who were finding businesses and trying to use them as agents of change. And that network was founded by my friend Josh Mailman, who is here today, and whose father's name is on at our school. Okay, I'm gonna talk to you. Really, our talks are, whoever put us two together was a great idea, thank you. Our ideas mesh very, very well, Mitchell's and mine. I'm gonna talk to you about developing communities of opportunity. So this is just a framework for how to think about what we call communities of opportunity. These are places where families can thrive and people can move ahead in their lives. And these are some of the components that we think are important within them: affordable housing, livelihood, places for jobs, access and mass transit, multiple choices of transit, arts and culture, neighborhood serving markets, including fresh food to overcome food deserts, parks and open space, healthcare and education. There are many other components, but these are just some of the critical ones. And the question we've been asking then is, can you start to take communities in a holistic way, put actually data on these, on each of these components of a healthy community, and map the pattern of to what degree is a community deficient or an exemplar of fulfilling the needs of its residents? And what you'll see is all over America, all over the world, that most of our communities have extreme areas of, they're very inconsistent. They have patterns that look like this. We think that the more you can actually use data to, and we think public health agencies are the ones to accumulate this data and feed that back, the better that we can then plan communities of opportunity and begin to shift our communities towards opportunity. And as Mitchell so eloquently showed, there are actually two things we need to do. We need to create new physical infrastructure, such as a park, but which I view as the hardware of these solutions, but we also need to integrate the software, which is programming. And that often we see fantastic hardware, but without the software built into it, it's not properly utilized. In the United, this is a chart. This comes from it's OECD data, and it comes from an organization called Children's Health Watch. And it's it's hard to read the lighting, but across the bottom are all the nations in the OECD, and the blue line is how much is spent on healthcare, and the red line is how much is spent on social services and other supports. And what you'll see is the United States, which does not spend the most, combine most of all nations, but you see the United States spends by far more, and typically about twice as much as every other OECD nation on health. But we also spend much less on social services, on pre-K education, on family support, on maternal leave, and all those things. And what we know from our, I'm sure you all know very well, I'm sure they teach it here, which is that our health outcomes are not the best of the OECD. Who knows, where do we rank of the?
Bottom.
The bottom, right, thank you. And there are 27, is it, OECD nations? 30, okay. So we're the bottom, we're the 30th of 30, and yet we're spending the most on healthcare. So why is this not working? And what you can see from this chart is, the answer is that, for example, the country on the far left, the first one is France, and the second one is Sweden, is that they are spending, and the third is Austria, far more, twice as much more on the social service side as they are on the healthcare side. That happens to be a much less expensive place to spend money. They're getting much more bang for the buck. And what, as a society, they're getting for is much better health outcomes. And so if we go back to this chart, what we can see is that actually by investing in the programs that Mitchell is trying to get funded, such as building parks and open space, by actually improving education, by creating neighborhood serving markets that provide fresh food, affordable housing, these other components, we pre-K, early child, we know so much now about the importance of 0 to 3 education, that actually the expenditures in those overall are cheaper for society. And so this goes back to the same point, which is we need to think in whole systems ways. my thinking, I think completely in system ways, and I think of everything as an ecology. In fact, all life on Earth is an ecology. And ecology is, to me, the most appropriate model when we think about any kind of system. It's the way nature actually designs systems to function. So when I think about urban systems, there is both an ecological system, and one of the reasons why it's so important to weave parks and gardens and open space and actual, not just trees, but actual true biodiversity back into cities is we need to actually restore their ecological functioning. But I also believe in something I call the cognitive ecology. And the cognitive ecology is really the collective ecology of all of our minds together and how healthy that is. And we actually see that in different neighborhoods functioning in different ways and different building types and functioning in different ways. And one of the things that I hope all of you study here is something called adverse childhood experiences. How many people here are familiar with the term? Okay, so that's most of you, which is great. So adverse childhood experiences are events that happen in a young child's life, and they break into three categories: abuse, family dysfunction, and neglect. For example, physical or emotional neglect, emotional abuse, sexual abuse, physical abuse. And what we're seeing is the data is really clear that if a family has six or a child has six or more adverse childhood experiences, they are likely to live 20 years less. So the prevention of these experiences has an enormous health outcome. There's also an enormous economic toll. The Center for Disease Control believes that it costs about 124 billion years per age cohort, so for all the three-year-olds now, and then another 124 for all the four-year-olds, et cetera. So it's an enormous, enormous cost to society. And we now know also that this is an exposure-related disease, and so the more, you'll see on the top, zero ACEs, one, two, three, four, and then you'll see the degree. So for example, four or more ACEs, you have a 236% increase in arthritis, 231% increase in cancer, in asthma, 157% increase in cancer, the lung cancer is higher, et cetera. So you can actually see there's like a dose response that's very, very negative on health. So I tell you all that because when I then think about housing and how housing fits into the larger ecological systems of neighborhoods and of cities, and it fits into the social system, the biological ecological system, and this cognitive ecological system. And our mission as a company is to restore places and to restore people within cities. Then I believe that we are all called upon to address the underlying drivers of disease. And the if our goal is health, then we need to understand what is ill and how do we cure that. So I'm going to give you an example of a project that Diane referred to, which is called Via Verde. So this is a view of the South Bronx, an aerial photo in 1996. As you can see, there's a vast amount of open space for a variety of reasons that I don't have enough time to go into. In the 1960s, 70s, and 80s, not only the South Bronx, but the inner cities of not only all over New York, but all over the United States died from decades of disinvestment and racism and the whole series of structural factors that really condemned them to a poor fate. And after a while, the city tore down all these abandoned buildings, and what was left was a vast amount of open space. And in fact, in the late 60s and early 70s, one of the questions was, should we have planned shrinkage? Should we actually just abandon these areas and contract into the core of the city? And Mayor Koch actually was the one who said no and actually began an affordable housing program that was then maintained decade after decade by mayors in the city. And this is why it's really important to have a vision and then to go beyond the political cycle, to have a multi-generational commitment to investment, and a system was set up that reinvested in rebuilding these neighborhoods. And this is a view actually from the roof of Via Verde, but of that same area, in which literally every piece of vacant land has been rebuilt. And what you can see, I'm going to step over here,
So the very first part of the rebuilding of affordable housing in neighborhoods would be low rise with New York City partnership homes, home ownership for cops and firemen for, and it's sold either, these are sold either as townhouses or duplexes in which people could begin to afford to live back in the city. It was a very cheap way to build, and it had low cost subsidies that went with it. As the subsidies grew, and as the ability to, we began to build more density. By the way, at this level of density, you could never support a subway system. You couldn't support the parks. At low density, you can't support the infrastructure that makes for healthy cities. But we began to come back then and build, what you'll see, as you look through this photo, what you'll see is
we began to build medium-rise housing, six and then 12-story block and plank buildings. They were plain, but they were good, decent, safe, affordable housing. And as you look through the photo, you'll see the housing gets more and more complicated, and then it becomes middle-income co-ops. And it's hard to see, it's a little shaded, but the building on the far right, which was most recently completed, is architecturally much more complex. And so you can see the phases, but it took these multiple years of commitment to rebuilding this the South Bronx neighborhood. Our company, this is some of the projects that we've been doing in Harlem and in the South Bronx. We have a cluster of work in this area. It's an area we're deeply committed to. The first thing in any location we believe that is most important is its access to mass transit. Number one, because if people don't have access to transit, they don't have access to the other elements of community of opportunity. They don't have access to jobs and food, et cetera. And the second thing is that mass transit is actually a walk extender. If you don't have mass transit, then the only way to get somewhere is by car. And it means if you get in your car, in your garage, and you drive, and then you get out the other side, you're never walking. We know how important walk is for health. Whereas if you walk seven blocks to the subway and then take it and then get out and then walk another five blocks to get to where you go, you're walking. And what's so amazing about the location of Via Verde, which is this red dot in the center of this image, is that it's accessed by both the 2 and the 5 subway, and one goes the east side and one goes the west side, so it really kind of gives you good diversified access. And this is right near the hub. The 2 and the 5 are meeting at the hub, which is a great place and was really the retail heart of the South Bronx. The site was a long, skinny site, and the city funded the rebuilding of the South Bronx. The rebuilding was done by community development corporations by a mixture of for-profit and not-for-profit developers. And I cannot emphasize how important community-based development organizations are in being the voice of a community. And they were the ones who actually, a group called Nos Cademos is really the one who master planned the South Bronx, this neighborhood in the South Bronx, who redefined the vision for what it was going to be. The city did not do that plan. And then these organizations got the funding to do the development along with private developers. A very important mix, this mix of private developers and not-for-profits. In this whole disposition process, there was this long, skinny site that was really difficult. It had a railway that ran through it. It was toxic, highly polluted, and so it was kind of the leftover site. So when then Housing Commissioner Sean Donovan decided he wanted to do a competition for a new model of what could be the latest in green affordable housing, there was concern that this competition could be a waste of money, and that why use a good site for it? So they took a bad site. And through a long and complicated process, this went for an RFP, and we won it, our firm, along with a wonderful not-for-profit called Phipps Housing, one of the oldest affordable housing developers and owners and managers in New York City. And we won it with a team of two architecture firms we put together, Grimshaw and Dattner. So here's a view of the site. It's actually next to a high school and has a good fence just for preventing access. So our first concept was, it's a very long, skinny north-south site. The goal is to be really green. And so we should should make it step down, that if it was high in the north and low in the south, we could create as much solar access as possible. And the second thing is we really wanted, many of you in the school are working on indoor air quality, we really wanted to make it every unit have cross-ventilation, so we wanted a lot of corners. Also because of affordable, low-income people can't afford air conditioning in the summer often, and it's another, we put ceiling fans all over the project. But the goal is to allow people to live in a cool environment naturally. This was just the first concept. It worked, but it wasn't the most attractive. This is the second concept. The concept kept evolving, and eventually it came into this model. So I have another thing. I've looked at the way indigenous communities are formed all around the world, the way cities evolve throughout the world, and I noticed an interesting pattern, which is that all cities have the most private realm, and what you see in many, many places is there's a family that gathers around very dense settlements, but around a courtyard or some interior private family space, and then that's connected by semi-private spaces, and you get this realm from private to semi-private to public, and typically there's a big town square in the public, and interestingly, that town square is the intersection of both the spiritual life of the community, it's in front of a church, and commerce. You actually see this mix of commerce and spirituality coming together. So we tried to duplicate that, but because it's such a tight site on the roofs. So progressing from the most private area in the roof to the most public and create a garden plan. We really believe that one of the solutions to gentrification and to the diversification of neighborhoods is both mixed tenure, so that means mixing rental and home ownership, and mixing incomes. So we designed half the project to be funded as low-income housing and the other half as middle-income co-ops. And interestingly, we say form follows function, follows finance. And so these are financed actually under different systems. I mentioned to you fresh air, and so we've focused a lot on cross ventilation. Our typical unit is actually a duplex where the air, as you see, can flow in one side and out the other. That also allows us to do something called a skip-stop elevator, where we eliminate corridors every other floor, so we increase the building efficiency. We use natural shading, so the building has these sun shades, and you can see how they shade the sunlight from entering into the units, so the units are cooler during the summer, but they're designed at exactly the right angle, so in the winter, the lower sun enters through the windows and actually provides solar heating. The other thing we did is we pushed the stairwells to the outside of the building for active living, and where you see those vertical lines, those are actually the stairs, and then daylit the stairs to make the stairs something to encourage people to actually want to walk in the stairs. You also can see some solar panels on the upper right, there's solar panels on the roof. And when we rebuilt the project, we saved some features like these are stones that were in the foundation, which are very annoying to find stones in your foundation, but then we use them as architectural features, as sculptural features. The ground of the project is an amazing, as we said, we really believe in like a town square, but also a children's play area, and that little stripped just slightly to the right is actually in the winter, in the summer we fill it with water and there's like a little stream flowing. So fantastic, very safe, all eyes on the neighborhood community play space. And then you see behind it there's an amphitheater. This is kind of an overview of that space. And you walk up the amphitheater and then it leads you into an orchard. So we're growing, we believe in what are called edible landscapes. We're growing fresh food for the families. And then that leads to a series of community gardens. We really believe in our projects in generating what we call the we rather than the me. And so instead of having individual garden plots, the families all grow for the collective. So they grow tomatoes for everybody, they grow lettuce for everybody, and then it's shared with everybody. And people have enormous pride in doing that. We collect rainwater and use it, the rainwater in the project for the gardens and also for laundries, et cetera. As you progress up, the gardens become more contemplative and quiet, and that leads into a gym. We think having gyms for exercise, et cetera, is great. And notice that this gym is on the seventh floor with light and air and overlooking rather than the basement in some crummy place. So it's an attractive place to be. This is an inside of, see the ceiling fan? I mentioned that the duplex units. I mentioned earlier that the physical programming has to be met with, the physical design has to be met with programming. And so, for example, we actively program the amphitheater with community events. By the way, in the orchard part, we have a Christmas tree farm, and we were going to cut the Christmas trees. We decided, actually, the community decided they'd rather light the Christmas trees there, and now the families all do the ceremony where they all come out and have their family pictures taken in front of the Christmas trees. That's something about the funding. I want to, you know, you can contemplate the funding while I, which is incredibly complicated, and if it was the business school, I'd go through all that, but you guys don't have to go through the funding part. But one of the things that was interesting is, so Diane mentioned this was built in a community-based process, but actually the community process is very truncated because this was done as an RFP and we were not allowed during the competition to talk to the community, which we actually would not recommend as a process. So, but one of the things that happened was there was one community meeting in which all the developers were allowed to come and listen to the community express their wants. So the first person gets up and they say, you know what I really want is I want you to design apartments with jacuzzis. And you know, everybody snickers and goes, and I sat there and thought, what is that person really saying? What they're really saying is, I want a place I can be proud of and a place that treats me with respect, and my health matters. And so in addition to being a really green place, we committed to it also being a really healthy building. So what you didn't see in the building is all the materials are non-toxic. We talked about fresh air, et cetera. We talked about trying to get people to exercise. There's a branch of Montefiore Hospital on the ground floor. We really tried to focus on not only environmental health, but human health. And we formed a partnership with New York City Department of Health, which is doing a baseline study. We are doing a health tracking over the over 5 years since people moved in. We're about year three or four now, so it'll be coming out soon, to look at how is the health, what are the health outcomes of the people who are living in this project, and then comparing that to an equal number of people who applied to live here and just didn't make it because there was a huge lottery, so not everybody could get in. So those are very equal populations, and we were very interested in seeing how those turn out. There is another aspect of health too, though, and I believe that's the spiritual aspect. This is King's College Chapel in Cambridge, England. It's an extraordinary building, one of the most extraordinary buildings on earth. This incredibly beautiful, organic, unfolding kind of fractal roof. It was designed by no one. There was actually, when the building began, somebody had a vision for this. And there was never an architect. The king kind of had this vision. The masons began to construct it. It took 100 years to construct. And so they passed from mason to mason down this pattern. And as the building was built, this incredible unfolding of this beautiful design that looks like nature, that actually reflects in some ways the architecture and unfolding of the universe, was created. And our buildings are missing that. And I actually deeply feel that making spaces like that is another key to making truly healthy communities. And I would end with a quote from Christopher Alexander, that making wholeness heals the maker. And as all of us are involved in the art of making wholeness in the communities that we work, it heals us too. Thank you.